Welcome, my dear students. Welcome back to our virtual classroom. Today we shall be dealing with a new topic, the biomagnification. But before delving into the depths of biomagnification, let me have a feel of your general knowledge. Mind my words, I am not talking about testing your general knowledge, rather just having a feel of your general knowledge. So have you heard about Inuits? Inuits, Inuits? No. Have you heard about Orca? S-O-R-C-A? You must have heard about penguins, the flightless birds distributed mostly in the southern hemisphere. And as soon as I name penguins, the ice-laden Antarctica might have come in your imagination. So rightly said and rightly got the point. I'm talking about penguins, the flightless birds, which are distributed mostly in the South Polar region areas, ice-laden areas of South Poles. So, what about Inuits and Orca? Before talking about these two, let me have draw a picture of a lactating mother in your imagination. You must have seen a mother nursing her child. The child in the lap of the mother, suckling the milk from the mother, and the mother, an image of satisfaction, a sense of satisfaction writ large on the face of mother, because she is providing her child with all sorts of nutrition, not only nutrition, but also protection against diseases. That is, the antibodies too are being provided through her milk to the child. And a sense of satiation is writ large on the face of the child because he or she is having the blessings of her mother, the boon of the mother's milk and the blessings of the mother in true sense. But what is wrong with it? I will talk it later on. Let me begin with the Inuits. Inuits are a population of aboriginal human beings restricted to the Arctic region of the Earth, the Northern Pole region, part of Canada, Greenland, Alaska of United States, and they live in their own without interacting much with the mainland population, and they have their ancient ways of living far from the luxuries of AC, cars and all that. The Orca is a toothed whale which is sitting atop the trophic level, atop the food chain in the ocean. It is a predatory whale which feeds upon all other fishes and other organisms, and it marshals entire ocean ranging from the North Pole to the South Pole. So you can say it is master of the ocean, a big predator, and the penguins you already know. So why am I talking about these in the class of biomagnification? Beginning with the mother is thinking that she is providing the best in the world to her child. But alas, that is not to be. You know, you will be startled to know that the mother's milk also have traces of DDT, the dreaded pesticide dichloro, diphenyl, trichloroethane, which we have long back band, but it is still passing from the mother to the child through her milk, the most sacred relationship between the mother and the child had been polluted beyond redemption, my dear students. Those aborigines, they are living far away from the belching smoke of automobiles, from the brown smoldering clouds emanating from the factories carrying acids with them, and from the pesticides being spread on the crops. Still, those unfortunate tribes, aborigines, they are having highest level of pollutants, if not highest, you can say one of the highest levels which have been found, which have been measured, which have been traced in a human being. So they are also polluted. The orca, which is sitting atop the food chain, which is the topmost predator, its body had been literally transformed into a body bag of pollutants. How is it possible? How we have polluted the entire range of populations of animals as well as human beings. The Inuits are living in the Arctic region, and the penguins are living in the Antarctic region. The Arctic population has got the pollutants. The Antarctic penguins, they also have DDTs in their muscles. So this is a very grim scenario, and all this has happened due to biomagnification. So let us see what is biomagnification, how does it take place, and what are the factors which should be looked into to minimize this process, to contain the process of biomagnification, and what the world community is doing to put a cap on the biomagnification process. So let us have a glimpse of the slideshow. So this is biomagnification. Biomagnification is happening due to buildup of pollutants in the food chain. So we have synthesized many chemicals which were not naturally present. Although all natural chemicals are not non-poisonous. Many of them are deadly poisonous, but we have learned to live with them because we have evolved, and they have we have got certain microorganisms which can deal with them, which can break them down, and so they are called biodegradable chemicals. But many of the chemicals which we have synthesized in one go, these chemicals are not that friendly, or the microorganisms or the microfauna or the converters or the detritus food chain, it has not got accustomed with those chemicals, and they have not evolved along with those chemicals, and they are unable to break them because they have not evolved enzymes to break them down. And so these non-biodegradable chemicals, although they are serving our purpose, but after serving our purpose, they simply do not disappear, they are not broken down, and they live in the environment for long. So what happens that when the concentration of these non-biodegradable chemicals built up in the atmosphere around an organism, the organism takes up these biodegradable, non-biodegradable chemicals from the atmosphere and they build up inside the body of the organism. If the removal system, that is the excretory system or the other systems which remove the undesirable chemicals from the body, they don't cope up, if the extent of removal is less than the extent of incoming chemicals, what happens? That the chemicals continue to build up, the animals retain those chemicals, and this retention of the chemicals in the biological system is called bioaccumulation. So what happens that when a chemical is bioaccumulated at the lowest level of the food chain? Food chain is the chain of eating and being eaten. So say, for example, if we are having a look on the food chain in the oceanic areas, we will have the phytoplanktons at the bottom. Zooplanktons feed on those phytoplanktons. Then small fishes will feast upon them. Then small fishes themselves will be eaten by the bigger fishes, still bigger fishes. And then the top level carnivores like orca will come into the picture and it will devour all them. So if the chemicals, the persistent chemicals, the chemicals which are not being degraded by the natural system, they build up inside the organism at the base of the trophic level, what will happen when these organisms are being, these producers are being taken up by the primary level consumers, secondary level consumers, tertiary level consumers, since these non-biodegradable substances are not metabolized. If you take carbohydrate from a plant, you will metabolize that carbohydrate to form carbon dioxide and water, and you will have energy. But if you get DDT, you won't metabolize DDT. DDT will continuously build up inside the your body, and as we move across atop the food chain, more and more DDT will be built up. And so this process of increase in the concentration of the chemical or the non-biodegradable substances or the persistent organic chemicals, many of them are inorganic too. So these persistent chemicals, they build up, and as they move, they enter inside the living system, and as they move atop the food chain in the process of eating and being eaten, they become more and more concentrated, and this increase in the concentration of the persistent chemicals as they move from the lower trophic level to the higher trophic level in a food chain, trophic level is the level of eating. So higher, from lower trophic level to the higher trophic level in a food chain, they get more and more concentrated. And so those sitting atop the food chain, that is the top level carnivores, they will have the highest concentration of that persistent chemical. And this process of magnifying the persistent chemicals in course of their transference from one trophic level to another trophic level is called the biomagnification. So they have highest level of concentration at the topmost trophic level, and this process of magnification in concentration as we move from one trophic level to the other trophic level is called biomagnification. So biomagnification is thus progressive increase in the level of toxicant persistent chemicals in the higher echelons of consumers, and they are highest in the top level consumers. Let's see through diagrams. Here you see there are fishes. As I told you, this color indicates level of contaminant, that is the persistent chemical, and these are the fishes. They do not have even traces of persistent chemical at all. But in course of time, since they are living in an environment in which there are plenty of persistent chemicals, they will take up persistent chemicals either through food or through permeable surfaces of their membrane, through the gills, through the skin, or through other parts of the body, and these chemicals are gradually being built up. This shaded area shows that this contaminant level is rising. Now, as the time progresses, the level has increased more and more. In this diagram, you can say the shaded area is far more greater than this diagram. So this process of accumulation of persistent chemical inside the living system, inside here, for example, the body of a fish, from the persistent chemical is entering, is being taken up from the environment inside the body, and the body is not able to cope up to remove those persistent chemicals because their concentration is far more higher in the environment. So the concentration builds up inside the body of the organism, and this process is called bioaccumulation. One of my students, his name is Pushkar, he has raised the question that, well, I could not understand the process of bioaccumulation. So bioaccumulation is very simple, Pushkar, because the concentration of persistent chemicals are higher inside in the environment, and although initially these organisms didn't have even traces of that chemical, but in course of time they got these chemicals from the environment through the permeable surfaces or through the food or through the other means, and since their excretory system is not able to remove that much of the chemical which is entering from the environment, the chemical is building up inside the body, and this building up of the persistent chemical inside the body of an organism which has been taken from the environment is called bioaccumulation. So it is very simple, accumulation of persistent chemicals inside the biological system taken from their environment is called bioaccumulation. Now, the next diagram, you see here, these are the smaller organisms, phytoplanktons or zooplanktons, whatever you may say. They may be some phytoplanktons, they may be zooplanktons too. And so these are fed upon by these small fishes. These small fishes here. And so these trophic levels, that is the primary producers and primary consumers. Primary producers are plants, that is phytoplanktons. Primary consumers are small animals, zooplankton. So the phytoplanktons and zooplanktons both are laden with these chemicals. Since the chemicals are in plenty, in the environment, these chemicals have entered inside their body, and these chemical laden food are being taken about by these fishes. So here bioaccumulation has taken place inside the primary producers, that is the phytoplanktons and the zooplanktons, and that zooplankton is when being taken up by the organisms at higher trophic level, that is big fishes, it enters inside the big fish head, and you see the concentration had increased here more than that was here. Now, when these fishes, big fishes, are being taken up by another organism, say for example, another big fish, the concentration you can see has increased far more. So here is trophic level 1, 2, here is trophic level 3, here is trophic level 4. So 1, 2 has far lesser amount of the contaminant, 3 is more than the 1, 2, 4 is still higher than the 3, and 5 has got far more higher level of contaminant in its body. So what do you see? You see that this contaminant is being concentrated more and more as it moves atop the trophic level across the food chain. From where has it reached here? From here. So it is moving through the food chain to the topmost level, and at the topmost level, its concentration has built up many times, and this increase or this build up in the concentration of a persistent chemical present in the environment is known as myomagnification. So it is magnification in the concentration of persistent chemical at the higher trophic levels. It is called biomagnification. So here it has biomagnified. A far simpler diagram is this. You see, this is the contaminant. Here you have lower trophic levels, the phytoplankton, the zooplankton. At lower trophic level, there are contaminants, but the concentration of contaminant is very low. But as we move through this trophic level, these smaller fishes, they have fed upon these phytoplanktons and the zooplanktons, and they have got far more pollutants, persistent chemicals inside their body. Then these fishes have been fed upon by the larger fishes. These larger fishes have still more amount of persistent pollutants inside their body. So the amount of the persistent pollutant is magnifying. It is being magnified as we move higher the trophic level, higher the food chain. So these are the fishes, piscivorous fishes. They eat upon the fish, piscivorous birds, they eat upon the fishes. And so you see there is maximum amount of persistent chemicals, persistent pollutants inside the body of these birds which are feeding upon the fishes. That is, they are sitting atop this food chain and they are having the highest level of these persistent chemicals. So these persistent chemicals have built up, have become more and more concentrated as we move from the lower level of the food chain to the higher level of the food chain, or in other words, from the lower trophic level to the higher trophic level of the food chain. Trojan horses gone berserk. Do you know about Trojan horses? No. Trojan horses have been mentioned in the Greek mythology, and they represent a disguised unwanted substance, that is a sugar-coated harmful chemical, you can say. What happened then when the Greeks were fighting their war, they sent horses made up of wooden horses which into their enemy territory, and these horses were taken as the twice as a friendly gesture from the enemy, and the enemy was baffled at these Trojans were carrying the soldiers, the Greek soldiers inside their womb, and as the Trojan horses were taken to the central place, the soldiers emerged and they defeated the enemy. So these Trojan horses are the mythical horses. They represent something harmful which had been disguised as something pleasant. So these hydrocarbons, they are being utilized by us since our early days. We have evolved with hydrocarbons, carbon having hydrogen attached to it, and we have utilized these hydrocarbons in multiple ways inside our body, very important organic matter. So we manipulated these hydrocarbons. Since these hydrocarbons are taken inside very easily, because we are accustomed in course of our evolutionary history with these hydrocarbons, so these hydrocarbons are taken up and utilized by the body in a very friendly and you can say efficient manner. So what we thought, that if we replace a few hydrogen atoms of these hydrocarbons and replace them by halogens such as chlorine, bromide, etc., they will become harmful. And like the Trojan horses, the body will receive them because they are hydrocarbons, and entering inside the body, they will play their true game and they will act as the pesticide and kill the insects. So the hydrocarbons in early 20th century, early to mid 20th century, we manipulated many hydrocarbons and we displaced, substituted the hydrogen by adding chloride, as happened in the case of DDT, dichloro, diphenyl, trichloroethane. So we replaced the hydrogens by the chlorides or bromides, etc., and we introduced these chemicals inside the body of the pests, the harmful insects which were destroying our crop. And since these are the hydrocarbons, the insect was befooled into taking up this hydrocarbon inside the body, and after entering into the body, they played their true games and the insects were killed in no time. So these hydrocarbons, manipulated hydrocarbons, chlorinated hydrocarbons, they have played very important role in our prosperity by killing the pests, by killing the vectors, the insects which carry disease from the one horse to the other. Say, for example, female Anopheles mosquito, which transmits, which vectors the malaria parasite. Say, for example, the phlebotomus, the sand fly, which transmits us with the dreaded kalajar. So these insects were controlled by the DDT or similar other chlorinated hydrocarbons, but these organic chemicals had got one pitfall, one darker aspect, and that darker aspect was that after performing their function, that is, after killing their target, they were not degraded so easily. What to say of easily? They could not be degraded quite at all. And that's how I said that Trojan horses gone berserk. They have, you can see, after fulfilling their purpose, they have also, they should have disappeared from the environment, but they are, what to say of disappearing from the environment, they are persisting in environment many, many more years, even after they have been banned, their production have been banned, and only they are being utilized only in exceptional cases. So these disguised hydrocarbons, they act as a Trojan horses, delivering the pesticides to the organisms, but these chemicals, since they have not originated in the natural way, since our microorganisms are not accustomed with them, they have not evolved with our microorganisms. So microorganisms don't have requisite enzymatic system, metabolic system to metabolize them, to degrade them, and that's why they are persisting and persisting for too long. So these persisting chemicals, they have been called POPs, persisting organic pollutants, although there are many inorganic pollutants too, which also persist, which have also got the property to persist inside the environment, but most of them are organic, and most of organic chemicals were utilized, were modified by us. So the main culprit behind the biomagnifications have been persistent organic chemicals, which were developed for our serving our purpose, but after serving our purpose, they could not be disintegrated by the natural system, and they persist in the system for too long, and they continue to play foul with the living world. So these are persistent organic pollutants. Persistent organic pollutants, we might have utilized the pollutants in a rice field in the remote corner of our villages. We might have utilized the chemical in the confines of our houses to kill the mosquito which were troubling us. But these chemicals have not been confined now to the fields of the paddy or the within the four walls of your house, but they have become ubiquitous. That is, they have become omnipresent. You can say they are like God, present everywhere. And these ubiquitous POPs are the main challenge for humankind, and they are main spoilers of the show. They are main culprits behind the biomagnification. It is due to these chemicals that both are right from Arctic to Antarctic, we are converting the bodies of the living beings into body bags of pollutants. So there are many POPs which are present across the world, and these are, I have told you, DDT, led by DDT, dichloro, diphenyl, trichloroethane, then PCB, polychlorinated biphenyls. So these PCBs are very important in electrical industry. They are utilized in the transformers, in the circuits, because they are not easily degraded and they can withstand high temperature. So we have utilized it in an unfettered way because we were unaware of its darker side. So we thought that we have got a magic wand and we were utilizing it. Similarly, polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons, these polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons, they are produced while we explore the oil, the petroleum oil, and utilize the oil for many purposes, its processing, etc. So these polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons called PAH are released there. Then we have some others, such as the brominated hydrocarbons, which we shall be dealing with in the next slide. But here, these are the organic persistent organic pollutants. But as I told you earlier, that many pollutants are persistent pollutants, may not be organic, they are metals. Say acidification of wetlands can give rise to the metals, and these metals gradually build up inside the biological system inhabiting those wetlands, say for example mercury, lead, etc., selenium. These are the main metal pollutants which have got the capacity to build up inside the living system. Mercury is transformed into the methyl mercury, another organic form, and it can easily enter inside the body and play havoc with the different systems of the body. So these persistent organic pollutants, as well as some inorganic pollutants too, they have become ubiquitous. They have become widely distributed across the world, and even when many of them have been banned, they are not anymore being produced. Still, they persist inside the system and they are troubling us. Then there are some emerging, rather they have already emerged, but since they have come later than those pollutants, they are called emerging pollutants, and they are fire retardants. When they started the use of foams and all other such materials, we faced the threat of fire, because these are highly volatile. These have the capacity to catch fire very soon. So they are mixed with, rather they have been coated with fire retardants, the chemicals which retard fire, such as PBDE, polybrominated diphenyl ether. So these brominated fire retardants, that is organic chemicals which were brominated, in which hydrogens were replaced by the bromines, they retarded fire. And so when we sleep on the mattress, we can have a sound sleep because we don't have the fear of it catching fire. But that sound sleep is far more dangerous, because we are inhaling these brominated compounds, these fire retardants, and these fire retardants will enter into our system, and they will play not only foul with our system, but they could be easily transmitted from the one trophic level to the other trophic level. And so we are transmitting the posterity too. Then there are perfluorinated chemicals. These perfluorinated chemicals, say for example perfluorinated octanoic acid. So this perfluorinated chemicals, they have came later in the series of persistent organic chemicals, and perfluorinated octanoic acid forms a Teflon covering on the utensils. The non-stickware that we use, they have got perfluorinated chemicals. And these perfluorinated chemicals are heat resistant. They serve our purpose. They have given an entire range of the non-stick utensils, wares, but they are persistent in the atmosphere. They can enter inside the living system, and they can build up as they move from the lower trophic level to the higher trophic level. Then there are engineered nanomaterials. Nanometer, 10 to the power minus 9 of meter. So we are also targeting the materials to certain systems. Drugs, pharmaceuticals, we are targeting those pharmaceuticals, smart pharmaceuticals. This would go directly to the system and mend the ways. They can destroy the system, they can destroy the organism occupying that system, or they can destroy a cancerous cell building up inside the system. And we can cut these chemicals to serve our purpose. If we can cut these chemicals into nanosize, say for example 1 to 100 nanometer, and these chemicals could be administered and they serve their purpose. So these are another Trojan horses they could be sent to the site of this turmoil, and but they can serve the purpose also there, but they don't disappear after serving their purpose, and that is the pain. That is the big worrying point, that these chemicals have not disappeared after serving their purpose, and their persistence is creating problems because they are poisoning the entire food chain. Next slide. The characteristics of POPs. What are the common characteristics of persistent organic pollutants? The common characteristics are they should be persistent. They should persist in the environment. They should not be easily broken down. They should not be easily transformed into their building materials. They should be flown from one place to the other, either through the water or through the air. So they should be mobile too. They should have the capability to enter the organic system, and they should have also be metabolically active, because only after they are metabolically active that they serve their purpose, and only after they are metabolically active that they produce challenge for we people. So they should be persistent, they should be mobile, they should be metabolically active, and they should build up as they move across the food chain. So how these chemicals enter into the living system? As we have seen earlier, as I have elaborated in my preface, that these chemicals, when they are present inside the environment or they are made to enter inside our body to serve a particular purpose, they are not biodegraded, they are not degraded by the system. So when the chain of eating and being eaten operates, at the lower level, the primary consumer takes primary producer, that is, the plants are taken by the primary consumers, the herbivores, and the herbivores utilize part of their energy for their own purpose, and the energy, rest of the energy is transferred to the next trophic level. But as we have seen, in case of energy transfer, the entire energy is not transferred to the next trophic level. Rather, the transfer of energy from one trophic level to the another trophic level entails loss of energy. It involves loss of energy as a perceptible hit, respiratory loss, and all other losses. So if an organism at higher trophic level has to maintain its activity, its life system, it will have to take more energy from its lower trophic level. So it will eat up more and more animals of the lower trophic level, and the organic chemicals thus gained could be metabolized to get the energy, but those persistent organic pollutants, they could not be metabolized, they could not be broken down. So what happens, that they are built up inside the body. And one characteristic in the previous slide was that they are lipophilic. Most of them are lipophilic, that they are fat loving, and we have the cover of fat. Almost all animals have fat inside the body, and we have the cover of fat, subcutaneous fat, such as blubbers in case of whales. So these blubbers, since these persistent organic chemicals are fat loving chemicals, the chemicals enter into the fat and get stored in the blubbers. So when the organisms enter from the environment at the primary trophic level, at the primary producer, then that primary producer is taken up by the secondary producer, the organism these chemicals, these persistent organic pollutants, they get transferred to the second trophic level, then to third trophic level, then to fourth trophic level. And since more and more food has to be taken to maintain the energy level by each higher trophic level, because the transfer of energy involves loss of energy, more and more organic pollutants, persistent organic pollutants enter the higher trophic levels, and so add these persistent organic chemicals move from the lower trophic level to higher trophic level, they become concentrated, far more concentrated, and far, far more concentrated. So they can be classified into two types, from the point sources and from the non-point sources. Point sources are that the water is being polluted by, from a different point, say from effluent from the factory or from the domestic sewage or from other sources. And here the non-point sources, these non-point sources are from general source of pollution, say for example flood, preservative, adulterants, etc., and they build up inside the water soil and they flow from one place to the another place, and ultimately they are taken up inside the human body and they are absorbed in the tissue and cell. Excretion though takes place, but excretion is unable to cope up with the entry, and so the buildup takes place and it causes toxicity, many risks, and that is the biomagnification. Now you can see a simplified schematic representation of the process of biomagnification. This triangle is the triangle of pyramid of biomass. So at the base of the food chain, we are the primary producers. You can see that the biomass is broadened. Here the biomass is far more higher than the top. So at the base of the food chain, producers are there at the base, and at the top, consumers are there at the top. So the biomass is minimum at the topmost level, where it is maximum at the lowermost level. And this pyramid represents the concentration of persistent organic pollutants or other type of pollutants which persist inside or which are biomagnified inside the body. So you see here that contrasting to the biomass, the level of pollutant is least at the level of primary producer. Here you have got the primary producers. So here the level of pollutant is least, and here you have got top consumer, topmost consumer. Here the level of pollutant is the highest. So you see here that the level of pollutant, level of persistent pollutants, it has magnified as we move from the lowermost level to the highermost level. So the biomass has decreased, but the mass of the biomagnifying chemicals has increased, and that shows the biomagnification, and that shows the deadness of the biomagnification, the dangers of the biomagnification, because here at the top, the biomass has shrunk, but the pollutants have expanded many, many folds, and it is due to this reason that an organism occupying at the topmost level of consumer, it has been turned into the mass, it has been turned into the body bag of persistent pollutants. So its biomass has shrunk to this level, but the pollutants has broadened to that level, and so it has become far, far, far more concentrated in having that pollutant. And that's why I told you in the preface that the Inuits or the orca, that is the tooth swells, which exists at the topmost level of the consumers, they have been literally reduced into the body bag of pollutants, because the persistent pollutants which were minimal at the base of the food chain, they have magnified at the topmost level, and those organisms were occupying the topmost level of the food chain. So they have been literally reduced into the body bag of the persistent pollutants. Now, what is the fate of these pollutants? You see here that some of the pollutants may undergo photodegradation, and they may be carried, may be degraded partly, or they may fit into the vegetation. They may be exchanged with the vegetation. They may be deposited at the air water interface. They may be taken up by the water, may be built up inside the water inhabiting organism, or they may remain at the surface of the soil and may be taken up by the crop which is being produced here, or they may be broken down, or if they are in the gaseous form, they may enter into the atmosphere, and by the precipitation they may be again brought down to the earth. So it is a system of circulation by which the non-biodegradable substances, particularly the persistent organic pollutants, they revolve, circulate and recirculate in the system, in the atmosphere, and thereby they continue to torment us. Now, there is very important process called grasshopper effect. In the beginning, I talked to you about Inuits. They are inhabiting Arctic region. We talked about penguins. They are inhabiting Antarctica. So Arctic region is also very far off from us, and Antarctica is also far away from us. And we are here in the mainland. We are utilizing those fire retardants. One of our student, Akansha and Saurav. Akansha and Saurav, you raised questions about fire retardants. I have already dealt with them, that they are brominated chemicals, PBDE, one example, polybrominated diphenyl ether, and they are retardants of fire, that they prevent fire in many substances such as foams, etc. So they have been utilized in fire retarding. They have prevented the fire in a household. They are utilized in furnitures also, TV sets also, materials which make up our fridge also, but they have the property of leaching. They may enter into the environment, and from the environment we people too, and they may be built up inside our body, or they may enter into the lower level of the food chain and continuously enter in the process of eating and being eaten up the food chain. So you might have got your answer. Now, coming to the grasshopper effect, what is grasshopper effect? You might, all of you might have seen the grasshoppers hopping from one place to another place. So I was talking about the Inuits, orcas and the penguins. They live in the remote corner of the globe, far away from the billowing smokes of the factories and the venoms being spewed out by the automobiles. Still, they have got so much higher level of these persistent organic chemicals. How? Have you ever pondered that how these remotely inhabiting animals, they are being polluted to such an extent that their body is being called the most polluted human race, or the most polluted predator? Let me elaborate it to the grasshopper effect. Of course, we are utilizing these chemicals for our own purpose, to serve our own luxurious lifestyle, or to safeguard our lifestyle in the plains. But these chemicals, since they are not degraded easily. They have got the ability to jump across. As the heat buildups, they jump across the geographical area from the equators to the poles. So this is called grasshopper effect. They are, as the heat falls upon, as the air circulation moves, they enter inside, they become, they are volatile. Many of them are volatile, so they enter into the atmosphere and they are carried by atmosphere to distant places, and this grasshopper effect evaporate out of the soil in the warmer region and settle in the cooler region. This diagram will show more clearly the grasshopper effect. Here you say colder polar regions are here, and so this from temperate zones here, what is happening? That in the warm area, it is evaporating, and with air circulation, it is being dropped here. In shorter jump, it is being dropped here and here. So they are hopping from one place to the another places as the heat buildups, and with the building of heat, building up of it, they move further in the upper areas and they move towards the colder polar areas along with the air current or along with the heat circulation, because they are volatile, and so their volatility carry them into the air as the heat falls upon them, and these volatile chemicals are carried with the air current from the temperate regions to the polar regions, and in the cooler polar regions they settle down. So when these chemicals, they are being utilized in the polar temperate zones or in the plains or in the equators, equatorial or tropics, wherever you can say, they are being utilized in the vast swath of land and breadth of the earth, but they are being utilized far away from the poles. But it is their property that they jump from the warmer areas towards the poles and settle into the colder polar region, whether it is northern pole or the southern pole. And in those polar regions, when they get there, they get frozen along with the water, along with the glaciers, and they remain there for years and years and years and years. So even while we have banned their production in the downland, in the glaciers of the poles, they are very much frozen. And when the global warming has caused the thawing of the frozen glaciers, they melt and they are dissolved in the water. Now take the case of penguins. Penguins feed upon krills, the crustaceans. So when the water melts in the polar region, what happens? That these chemicals which had got frozen along with the water, they become dissolved in the water, and these krills feeding upon thriving in those polluted waters, or those waters having plenty of persistent organic pollutants, these krills get those POPs, persistent organic pollutants, from the surrounding, from the thawed water, and build up inside their body. That is, the bioaccumulation is taking place, and when these krills are being fed upon by the penguins, biomagnification is taking place. Those persistent organic pollutants which had built up inside the krills, since more and more krills are being fed upon by a single penguin, more and more persistent organic pollutant is being supplied to a penguin directly. There is no intervening tropic level from the water to the krill to the penguin. So the penguins are being directly poisoned, and it is due to this reason that the penguins have traces of DDT and other persistent organic pollutants inside their muscles. Take the cases of orca. Orca sits atop the food chain. It occupied the highest trophic level. It is one of the topmost carnivore of roaming the ocean from this pole to that pole. So it is distributed widely. So what happens that it feeds upon a number of lower trophic level occupying organisms, that is smaller fishes to larger fishes to still larger fishes. And since biomagnification is taking place in those fishes, and since the food chain is far more longer in oceanic environment, it entails building up more and more persistent organic pollutants inside the body. And that's why when it reaches orca, what happens? It becomes concentrated to the ultimate level, that is, the body of orca is being poisoned by the persistent organic pollutants. And since those Inuits, unsuspecting Inuits, innocent Inuits, they are living in a corner, in an Arctic corner, they feed upon the fishes. And these fishes have already been biomagnified by the persistent organic pollutants. So the level of persistent organic pollutants in these fishes has got increased to far more higher level. And since they eat upon these fishes, in their body, this organic pollutant is attaining a new level, that is, the biomagnification is touching a new height, causing untold miseries upon them because they are reaping the sins that we have committed. They are paying for our sins because it is we people who have used and utilized and thrown the persistent organic pollutants across the globe, and those unsuspecting orca who are living in a remote corner, they are unknowingly eating upon them, building them inside the body, and these organic chemicals, the high level, or the rather the highest levels of organic chemicals, is playing havoc with their physiological system. They are intervening in their neural integration. Their motor senses are being numbed. Their endocrine system is being affected. Their reproductive potentialities have been decreased. Teratogenic changes are taking place. Deformities are taking place. That is, the birth of children having deformities is taking place, but they don't know why. They might have been cursing some bad spirit, some, you can say, wicked spirit, but no, that wicked spirit lies in ourselves. We people have polluted the environment to such an extent that even those who are living in the pristine purity of the environment have to bear the fruits, have to bear the burden, have to pay for us, and their pristine environment have been polluted to such an extent that it is perhaps beyond redemption. Now, in this slide, you can see that how these persistent organic pollutants, they affect us. And so you can yourself have an idea. There is nothing to elaborate. So we have system different pollutants such as PBDE that I have explained to you, polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons, polybrominated diphenyl ethers. So these are playing havoc with our system. They alter our behavior. They lead to memory loss. They lead to nervous dysfunction. They lead to reproductive impairment. And one remarkable change that these chemicals have caused in birds is that they have led to the thinning of the outermost layer of the birds. So those birds which sit atop of the food chain, say eagles and birds of prey, they prey upon the fishes, and since these fishes have already been contaminated to greater extent, so these contaminants built up inside the body of these birds of prey, and these intervene the egg formation in their body, and the eggs are laid down with very thin outer hard layer, leading to the non-emergence of the chicks, and that's how their population is being affected. What we people, the humanity, the enlightened humanity, you can say, represented by us, are doing to ameliorate the condition, to redeem the situation from the brink, and we have gone for a convention which is called Stockholm Convention, and it was signed, we were signatories in 2001, and it has come into effect in 2004, and it has graded, it has enlisted in its section A, schedule A, certain chemicals which are threatening untold miseries of the biomagnification upon us, and it has been resolved to prevent them use, prevent their use, prevent their production, and also for elimination of whatever chemicals have been left inside the environment. So these we are at the global level, we are making a concerted effort to mop up, to stop production, to eliminate all these chemicals which are persisting inside the environment, which are persisting beyond our imagination, and not only persisting in the environment, but they have entered inside the living system, our bodies too, and from the food chain, that is the chain of eating and being eaten, they have gradually moved upstairs, and while they have moved upstairs, they have become far and far more concentrated, and due to the higher level of concentration, those organisms which are occupying the highest trophic level, they have been the threatened most. So coming to the end of our discussion, I am again going to the beginning. In the first section, in the preface, you can say I have talked about a nursing mother. Nursing mother was well satisfied that she is blessing her child with all the protections and all the nutrients required for his growth or development, his or her growth and development. But in fact, she is poisoning her child with the dreaded DDT. Now you can say that when DDT production has been banned and when it is no more produced, how still at this point of time, these days, DDTs are being injected into the population through the mother? Because mother's mother also, while she was lactating, milked her, nourished her, and in course of that divine nourishment, unknowingly or inadvertently, you can say, she poisoned her child. So that female child got DDT from her mother, and that lipophilic DDT got dissolved or stored in the lipid of her body, and when she is lactating, she is transferring fatty acids from herself, her body, to her child, and through that transfer, DDT is again being transferred to her female child, and that female child, when she will be her child again, she will also lactate her child, and she will again, in course of lactating, in course of nursing her child, the unsuspecting child, while suckling her mother, is also sucking the DDT, and so the DDT is being transferred from one generation to the other generation. It is not only DDT, but other persistent organic chemicals which are present, which were present inside the body, are still present and are being transferred to the future generations too. So we are cursing our generations to come through the persistent organic chemicals, and those persistent organic chemicals, besides playing foul with their nervous system, with their memory, with their endocrine system, with their childbearing capacity, is again being transferred to her child too. So in this way, we can see that although we have prevented the production, we have put a cap on their production, but still they persist. And most of the countries have banned DDT in the late 60s and 70s, but DDT is still being traced inside the mother's milk, and that is the most sacred thread of our life. The link between a mother and the child has been poisoned, and my God, I fear it has been poisoned beyond redemption, and we should do all that we can do to redeem this sacred thread to its sacred most level. So that was all about biomagnification. We have seen that how these chemicals silently magnify as they move from the lower trophic level to the higher trophic level. And by giving one example of the mother nursing her child, we can see that how dangerous proportion it has assumed. I have tried to answer the questions which have been raised earlier by my students, and I welcome more questions from my students. Till then, thank you. Bye.